yeah, I came here from Munich, from the University in Munich, and so this was my project, a trait-based approach to determining flower visitation by pollinating bees, and we used Vicia, faba, and Phaseolus vulgaris as model species. And so my direct supervisor was Dr. Barbara Smith, but I couldn't have done the work that I have without Francis and Judith, so thank you very much. And well, as you said, the project was done within the True project already. So the True project aims to increase sustainable legume cultivation across Europe. And the study is focused on a specific case study that aims to investigate heritage varieties for enhanced and human beneficial insect nutrition. Yeah. So actually the work was focused on bees, but it's important to contextualize the research in the agricultural branch as well. So the target of agriculture is to maximize yield, and bees are, well, main pollinators, and they're known to increase yield. So it's important to keep the bees happy so the yield can be increased as well and can benefit agriculture. So these were my model species. So Vicia faba, which is the broad bean, and Phaseolus vulgaris, the French bean. And well, it's a lot of names, but these are the varieties. And it's maybe just important to say that so from the broad bean, the five first ones were modern varieties, and the rest. So crimson flowered is a special case. It was a heritage variety, and now it's kind of back in the commercial varieties again. But they still listed it as heritage varieties. And from the French beans, these first four are modern varieties. And it's also important to say that we obtained the seeds from the heritage seed library. So a little bit about the flower. They have a really unique flower structure. So you can see these big petals are the standard petal here, and the wing petals and the keel petals, like, together. And they have a single axis of symmetry. And it's kind of interesting because both crops are known to be self-pollinating, and still it has been found that pollination still increases yield. So it's still important to bees visit them. So what attracts the bees to the flowers? So it could be color, it could be the rewards, which could be nectar or pollen. And it could be the scent as well. But I was mainly focused on the nectar, the amount, and the nectar volume and sucrose amount, and also the flower morphology, so the size of the flower. And if you can see here, the nectar lines, so they're different color to the rest of the petal, and they normally point towards the rewards in the flowers. It's a lot, but it's so these were my questions, and I'm just gonna read the first part of them. So I wanted to see if the flower color is different, and then I asked the question twice for between all of the varieties and between heritage and modern. So here's like all the questions again, but heritage and modern. And so I wanted to see if the colors of the flowers are different. I wanted to see if the flower size between the varieties or between modern heritage is different. I wanted to find out if the nectar quality, so sucrose amount, is different, if the nectar volume is different, and if bees have a preference between the varieties or between modern and heritage varieties. Oh yeah, I forgot to, sorry. normally, well, you stipulate a null hypothesis for all of your questions. So my null hypothesis was always that there's no difference. So there's no difference between all the varieties, and there's no difference between modern and heritage varieties. So to my methods. So the first thing I wanted to do was assess the bee community we have here. So I used two different approaches for this. The first one was the pen traps, which is like you take three bowls painted with different colors, which is yellow, blue, and white, and then you fix them on a wooden post, and yeah, you leave them out in the field, which I did for 48 hours. And then afterwards you can, I don't know, take the bees to the lab and analyze them. So the positive side of it is you don't have to have so much knowledge on the field, because you have time to analyze the bees in the lab afterwards. But the bad side, it didn't really work. So I left them out and I just catched a few bees, like some solitary bees and yeah, some just one bumblebee. And also what I wanted to test, if there's a difference between just the bowls or bowls with simulated nectar guides. Yeah. Which also, there was no difference, so it didn't really work. There wasn't. But anyway, the other approach was the bee observation, but this was kind of, you had to have more knowledge, because I did go out in the field. I selected some flower-rich areas around the site, and so I visited them every week for 10 minutes. And then I looked at which kind of bees we have and which flowers they visited. And yeah, so this worked better.
where are the sites?
Yeah, so roughly kind of around here. It was really nice. Then also along here, here and in the field, because there were like some different flowering crops as well, so I looked at them, so mainly here, and yeah, it wasn't, I think it was only five different sites. Okay. So then for my nectar, I had to cover the flowers up so the bees wouldn't drink all my nectar before I could measure it. So I did this like 24 hours before I measured it. So with the broad beans, it was really simple, like just covering them up. But with the French beans, it was a bit more tricky. So, well, but it worked. I could get some nectar to measure. So, since the plots were actually small, I didn't have a lot of flowers, and I wanted to measure the nectar, but I also wanted to see the bees visiting the flowers, so I couldn't really damage the flower to measure the nectar, so it was kind of tricky. But then you insert a capillary tube in the right position in the flower, and then the nectar just comes out. So here you can really see. So the nectar comes up until here. And then what I did, so you know, you have different kinds of capillary tubes, like 1 microliter and 5 microliters that I used. And then I measured how much nectar volume, in the, like how many millimeters I had, and then converted it to see how much microliters and the total amount of sucrose per flower that I had. And also then you use the refractometer to, and it gives you the amount of sucrose, the percentage of sucrose. Questions? No? Okay. So then for the results. So I found all of these bees on the site, mainly with my bee observation. So there's the tree bumblebee, solitary bees that I didn't further analyze to species, so just call them solitary bees. The common carder, the early bumblebee, the red-tailed bumblebee, the honeybee, and the garden bumblebee. And for the buff and white-tailed, they look exactly the same in the field, so I just put them together. And actually, I'm gonna go back to this again, but since I had really low bee visitation, in the end for the statistics, I still had to group everything together. But it's still nice to see the bee variety that we have here, so it's really important. And then these are the results for my flowers, so to analyze the color of the flowers, and also what you can see, for instance, so here are the broad beans and here are the French beans, that the French beans, they don't really have these nectar guides, or you can't really see them. And I tested looking at them also under UV light, but still it doesn't, you can't really see the nectar guides. So yes, what's also interesting to say is that here you have kind of almost the same color pattern along all varieties except for crimson flowered and beryl, so beryl's all white. But if you look at it under UV light, you can see the nectar lines a little bit. And here it's also interesting to see that you have different kinds of colors, but so the colors are not different, so the modern varieties are not really different than the heritage varieties. So we have pink color here and in the heritage as well. So then I also measured the flower length. And so you can see, and then I used an ANOVA test, which is an analysis of variance. And then I plotted the results with the means and the standard deviation. And then you can see there are some significant differences with the flower size. And also you can see that there's not a pattern that says that heritage is different from modern. So we have bigger flowers in modern and in heritage as well. Questions? No? And then for my sucrose, I also plotted everything together that I had. And it's kind of boring, the statistics. But what you can see, hopefully, is that with rising temperature, so the first week was kind of warmer than the second week. So sorry, I should have mentioned this before. I measured everything for 4 weeks. So here I have week 1, 2, 3, and 4 for the broad beans. And then what you can see that this week the temperature was a bit higher than on the second week, and you can see the patterns are, you have a bit more sucrose amount than on the cold weeks. And I found in the paper that there can be a correlation between temperature and sucrose amount in the nectar. So what also is kind of important to say in the results is that the broad beans, they flowered really differently from one another, the varieties. So like in this week, we don't have all varieties flowering. I think the only week that everyone flowered was the second week of measurement. But you see that here, they probably go to a decline already, and then they stop flowering. And then the heritage varieties start flowering more towards the end of the season. Okay. This is the sucrose result from the French beans. And so you can't really compare French to broad beans because they were sown in different times of year. So the broad beans were sown and measured in July, and this one in September, the French beans. But it's still interesting to see that they have less amount of sucrose averagely than the broad beans. And yeah, and also you can see that there is no direct pattern that says that, I don't know, heritage is better than commercial. So I measured also the nectar amount, and also again you can see you have representatives with more nectar or less nectar from both modern and heritage varieties from the broad beans, and also from the French beans. They were a bit more even, the French beans, with some, I don't know, some exceptions, which was Black San Antonio. But yeah, I'm gonna go back to this later. So yeah, now the results of the bee visitation. So I don't know, what was really interesting to find out is the only species visited the broad beans did also visit the French beans. So only three species, which was the buff-tailed, the honeybee, and the common carder. Because you would think that since the flower size was different from the French beans and the broad beans, and also the color pattern, you could maybe find different kinds of bees visiting them. But yeah, no, it was still the same bees. This could be related that these bees were the most common on the site. So in numbers, they were the most common bee species that I found. Oh yeah, what I also wanted to say is, you can see in this picture, the, for example, the buff-tailed bumblebee, it has a short tongue, so it can't really nectar the correct way on the broad beans, but it has a little trick, so it just bites a hole here at the bottom of the corolla, and then it just can nectar from there. So it's called nectar robbing. And this is the correct way, so the the common carder is just, it's a long-tailed, a long-tongued bumblebee, and it can nectar the correct way. And here I made a short video. Oh no. Why isn't it working?
Maybe there's
a mouse rather than touching. Oh. Maybe. Yeah. Emily has a little bit. Okay. So now this is the results of the bee visitation on the broad beans. So strangely, on the first week I didn't see any bees on them. So they, I don't know, they were on strike or something. But yeah, so actually the bee visitation, you visit all the plots for 5 minutes, and then you just stand there and look which bees come along, and then you can see which species. So no bees on the first week. On the second week it was raining the whole week, so I also couldn't take any bee observations. And then I could only see bees on the last 2 weeks. And as you can see, it's really really few bees visited the varieties. And also they just visited some of the varieties, which could also actually, the problem was that the first variety were already dead, so you couldn't see the bees on them, of course, because they weren't flowering anymore, but still a few number of bees. This is from the French beans, And so you can see there is a bit more of bee visitation going on, but it still isn't a lot. And well, what's also important to see probably is that you have visits on the modern and on the heritage varieties. So there's like no big preference for one variety. So then now I could answer with all my results, I could answer my questions. And for comparing all the selected varieties, my null hypothesis that there was no difference between the varieties could be rejected, because you could see there were some differences between the varieties. And this applied actually for all my questions. So the flower color was different between some of the varieties. The flower size was clearly different between the varieties. The nectar quality was also different, and the volume and also bee visitation was different between some of the varieties. But this is kind of the bee visitation was kind of it didn't have statistical significance because of the, I didn't have much data to test. But when you compare modern and heritage varieties, then I couldn't really reject my null hypothesis, because there wasn't a clear pattern saying that there was a difference between modern and heritage. So you can't really say that there's a difference. So my conclusions were that there was a really low bee visitation. This could be because the bees were more attracted maybe to other plants flowering than our crops. But you could see that bees were more attracted to some varieties over others. As I said, there was no difference between modern and heritage varieties, and nectar volume and sucrose concentration varied between varieties, but both heritage and modern had representatives with high nectar volume and high sucrose amount. And while the results did kind of suggest that there is a tendency for bees to visit more the heritage over the modern, but still they visited modern, so you can't really. So it should be tested again, actually, to be on the safe side. And this is a bee feeding on our weeds on the plots. So yeah. And then there are some thoughts for future research in this area. So maybe bigger plots would be better. And also maybe with a mix of both crops, because they had this time difference, so you can't also compare French beans to broad beans because they weren't sown on the same time period. It could be interesting to do this experiment in control conditions, maybe in a glass house, so you could introduce bumblebee colonies. This would rule out temperature variations probably, because what also was the thought is that you can't really say that the nectar amount or the sucrose amount varied if it was an effect over the age of the plant or if it was an effect on the temperature or external conditions, and maybe one variety did better than the other one in, I don't know, stress conditions or something. But then again, these control conditions wouldn't be the real thing, actually. So you have to be careful with that. It would be nice to do more bee observations. In my small experiment, I couldn't do more because of lack of time. Because I had to measure everything on the same week, so I couldn't squeeze in more bee observations, sadly. And it would be interesting to observe and investigate other flower traits, maybe like pollen or the flower scent. That's it. Thank you. Yeah.